Welcome to I'm Your Target Demographic. Now today we are going old school. So not only is this nerdy comic book stuff, but we are going back to a comic book that came out 15 years ago. Wait, 18, 19 years ago? A long time ago. So, we are talking today about Generation X. Now when I was a kid, I was in like fifth grade maybe when I started kind of really getting into comic books, and Generation X was the title that just came out. I could get on right when it was starting. I kind of liked the X-Men, I knew enough about them, but this was a team that was kind of young people just like me learning to use their powers. So I really latched on and really kind of became obsessed with this comic run. It only lasted for about 4 or 5 years, the creators left, it lasted a couple more years, just eventually died. But some of the characters introduced in Generation X are still around, still doing stuff. So we're going to go over who was in this team, what they did, where they've been, and where they are now. Some of them are not alive anymore, some of them are full-fledged X-Men. So let's dive in. So Generation X, the premise was this was a team of young mutants learning to use their powers, but for the first time they weren't mentored by Professor X. So this team was led by Banshee and the White Queen, Emma Frost. So they taught these kids kind of how to use their abilities. Most of them, their abilities were kind of very extreme or physically altered them. So it was a group of misfits trying to learn how to use their powers. But Banshee and the White Queen were the ones that kind of helped them out. And the only recognizable member of Generation X when this book started was Jubilee. Now, Jubilee was a member of the X-Men, but she was always the youngest, kind of the sidekick. So now they kind of put her with her peers to do some awesome stuff. And Jubilee's powers are basically to shoot out what she calls fireworks, which are basically these bursts of energy that she can kind of shoot out of her fingers, and they can go wherever she wants them to go and explode whenever she wants them to. So she basically used these for blasts to kind of hit people and whatnot, but her potential was incredible. And the White Queen even said that if she could master this, she could alter things on a subatomic level and be one of the most powerful mutants that she'd ever seen. But Jubilee is young, irrational, and never really gets to that point of using her powers to that extent. So in Generation X, she's the only one that we kind of know of. So what happened then? So Generation X happened for a couple years. Eventually she leaves. She's out on her own, kind of doing her own thing. And then the event Decimation happens, M-Day, which means there's no more mutants, right? So she loses her powers, doesn't know what to do. She becomes a renegade for a while, kind of tries to get suits and stuff to kind of fight crime. Then eventually, the writers do this really strange storyline, and this is where she is now. She is bit by the son of Dracula, and Jubilee is now a vampire, which means she has all the abilities of a vampire, so super strength, speed, and the ability to turn into a mist. But she has all the weaknesses of a vampire as well, meaning garlic, sunlight, stake to the heart, things like that. So she is now basically, I think she's with the X-Men, but she is still a vampire, fighting crime. Strange turn of events for Jubilee. Up next, we have the mutant Skin. He is cleverly named Skin because he has about 6 feet of excess skin. He can kind of control this, like elastic. He can wrap his fingers around things, capture people, stretch his arms. His bones are not stretchy, but his skin is, so his bones kind of move around inside of his skin. Kind of gross. His skin is a gray color, and he kind of lied to a lot of people and said he had elephantitis, you know, different diseases that would cause graying of the skin because he didn't want to be known as a mutant. Skin grew up in East Los Angeles, and he was part of a gang, and as soon as his mutant abilities started to manifest, he freaked out. He faked his own death, got out of there because he knew people would hate him, his family would hate him. So he basically faked his own death, went and joined Generation X. Now, after Generation X, what did Skin do? For a while, him and Jubilee became roommates in Los Angeles, and she went on to try acting and whatever. Didn't last very long because a group called the Church of Humanity found them and crucified them on the lawn of the X-Mansion. Now, everyone is up on these crosses. Angel, Warren Worthington III, was able to use his blood to heal them. And everyone is healed except for Skin. For some reason, he was immune to this blood. It might have been because of his skin. But he died. End of story. Next up, we have a mutant named Mondo. Now, this is a really kind of strange story, because Mondo, I first learned about him when trading cards came out, and one of them was Mondo, and I was really excited for Generation X already, and his favorite quote is, "Life is too serious to be taken seriously." And this is still my favorite quote. When I fill out things, it says, "What's your favorite quote?" I put that. It's awesome. And so I was so excited for Mondo. But it turns out that the Mondo that was on Generation X was a clone created by Black Tom Cassidy. And the real Mondo was with Black Tom Cassidy and the Juggernaut, and they were kind of doing horrible, evil things. So Mondo is a villain. The real Mondo that we got attached to and read about was a plant clone. Okay, really strange. But Mondo, his powers were to basically touch things and absorb them. So he could touch wood and his hand would become wood, or he could become stone, or he could become whatever he touched, he could absorb and become. Which is pretty cool, but it's just betrayal. When you find out that the character you liked was a clone and the real one is a bad guy. Now Generation X eventually faced off against Black Tom and the Juggernaut and Mondo. They fought. The three villains were defeated, but managed to escape. But that was back in the year 2000, and Mondo has not been seen since. So he is still alive, but he's a villain, and he's out there doing who knows what. So I'm just waiting for some author to come back and be like, let's use Mondo for something. But it may be a while. Up next, we have the sister of Cannonball. And I talked about Cannonball a few videos ago when I talked about the New Mutants. Paige Guthrie, her name is, and she is called Husk. Husk is able to shed her skin and expose something underneath. So it might be steel, it might be wood, it might be whatever she needs it to be at the time. Or it could be a mystery, it could be unpredictable, so it could just be a what's under here. So that's her power. She is a husk. So she joins Generation X because her older brother is on, I think, X Factor at that time. So she joins Generation X. She starts a romance with a character called Chamber, which we'll talk about here in a little bit. But things don't really work out. After Generation X broke up, Husk went on to try to find her friend Jubilee, who at this point was a vampire. So Husk goes out looking for vampires. She gets surrounded by them, kind of, she's going to be overtaken. She sheds her skin, and she becomes a living wooden stake. And she kills all these vampires. And I don't know if she ever found Jubilee, but either way, she killed hella vampires. Now, after that, she became romantically involved with Warren Worthington III, Angel. So that's a bit of a step up from Chamber. So they became a thing, didn't last for super long. And then that's when things started getting weird for the character Husk. She went through a secondary mutation, which is when your mutant abilities take on a new spin or they become more powerful, something happens. And her secondary mutation was that she could husk and become multiple things at once. So it could be multiple textures or multiple types of whatever. But with that, she started to lose her mind. Her skin kind of was like flaky all the time. She was like molting, and she started to kind of have like little psychotic breaks. And she became somewhat romantically involved with the character Toad, which is a big step down from Warren Worthington III. But turns out, eventually she figured it all out. She's like, okay, what I'm doing is wrong. I need help. Left the bad guys, because she had been with Toad and the Brotherhood, or whoever Toad is with at the time, the Hellfire Academy, I think. So she left them, and she's like, I need help. So that's where Husk is at right now. In the stories, it's been a couple years. She's looking for help. Eventually, maybe she'll rejoin the X-Men when she has control over her secondary mutation. Up next, we have a character called Sync, Everett Thomas. Sync was able to, if he was close enough to someone, sync up with them. Right? So if he was near Jubilee, he could sync up with her and use her power. So he had this aura that could kind of sense mutants, what they could do, and then he could do that as well. Sometimes he could even do it better than them, like when he synced up with the character Chamber, he could fly. And Chamber was like, I can't fly. So he could sometimes use people's powers in ways that they didn't know that they could. But if Sync gets far enough away from someone, he starts to lose control of that power, or it gets weakened, and so there's a scenario where he's protecting a bunch of kids from a bomb. And he gets to the bomb, and he manages to throw it, but he's so weak and his powers aren't that great anymore because he's so far away that the bomb kills him. Now this sucks, and he had been somewhat intertwined with a character called Monet, M, and she's distraught about it, and Sync is killed. We do, however, see Sync and Skin again. The two of them are resurrected in the arc Necrotia, which is the Black Queen Selene basically raises a bunch of mutants from the dead and uses them to do this nefarious plan. And so for like a panel, we see Sync and Skin and they're alive. I assume after that storyline, they all died again because there's no more use for them. So I assume that Sync and Skin are still dead, but it was nice to see them for like a second. Up next, we have the character Chamber, who is probably one of my favorites. Now, Chamber is a kid named Jonathan, and he was just minding his own business with his girlfriend one day, and when his power manifested, an explosion of energy blew out of his chest, and it basically destroyed his chest and his jaw. So now there is just a continual energy coming from him. So he needs to sometimes wear like a bandana thing to like hide it, but there's a bigger question of why doesn't that energy like destroy that, you know, scarf or whatever, which doesn't make sense, but don't think about it too hard. So Chamber, because he doesn't really have a mouth, he doesn't need to eat, drink, breathe. He doesn't need to do any of that stuff. Basically, it's assumed that he is that energy and his body is just a shell, like that energy can kind of live in. So like there's a mutant that tried to like use like a death force on him and it was like there's no life force to be found. Like he's just that energy now. So Chamber, obviously distraught by this, right? He doesn't have a jaw anymore. He talks telepathically, which is kind of creepy. He looks kind of creepy. So he's very down about that. So he's a very dark, brooding character. He had a relationship with Husk. Didn't last long because he's a downer and she's not having that. So didn't last long. It's believed that Chamber could be a potential Omega-level mutant, but his insecurities and self-doubt really stop him from tapping into even a portion of that power. But if he got over that and really embraced it, he could be really, really powerful. So after Generation X broke up, Chamber was looking for purpose. So he was with the X-Men, and he decided to infiltrate the Weapon X program. So he had a fight with Husk, and he was, you know, she's with Angel. So he like blows up a bar or something, and he goes to Weapon X and says, "Hey, I'm willing to like undergo some experiments or whatever if you can help fix me." Really, he was infiltrating them, but they believed it because they heard about this bar he just blew up, whatever. So he goes to Weapon X, but a riot happens. Things go crazy. Now, just at the same time, Decimation happens, and Chamber loses his power, which basically means he now has no jaw and no chest. Luckily, Beast is able to kind of create this like system that keeps him alive, but it's not super great. But he's alive. Now, during this whole thing, this group of people called Clan Akaba find him, and they claim that Chamber is a descendant of the mutant Apocalypse. So they're like, "Come with us, we can heal you, we can fix you, and we can give you all these powers that you never even dreamed of." So Chamber goes with them, and they kind of do this ceremony kind of thing with the blood of Apocalypse, and I don't know how they got it. It heals him. Okay, so it makes him full, and it gives him this kind of tattoo kind of thing that's like the symbol of Apocalypse and his family line. And so he's fixed, but he doesn't have any powers. So he's just a guy. He doesn't chill with them for long. He leaves them and goes back to the X-Men, and he's like, "Okay, I'm back, whatever, but I don't have any powers." So he gets this technological getup that gives him powers, basically. It's like a costume, like a weapon. And it allows him to make sounds as a weapon. So kind of like Banshee does. Like he can kind of like yell and do things. And it says that he can kind of create objects, kind of like a Green Lantern kind of thing, like a hard light object. So they call him Decibel for a little bit, and he fights crime alongside Jubilee and a group called the New Warriors for a while. Now, long story short, where is Chamber now? During a storyline involving the Omega-level mutant Legion, Legion kills Chamber. But then at the very end of the story, he brings him back to life, and he's exactly the way he used to be. Okay, so he's Chamber as we know him, with the energy in the chest. Nothing has changed. Which means the writers did this whole Apocalypse story, and they didn't really know what to do with that or what to do with Chamber, so they're like, "We like the old Chamber, So they put him back exactly the way he is. And he's around. He's kind of with the X-Men. He goes on a lot of really important missions. Like, he went with them to look for the Red Skull. He does a lot of really important things, and he's still around, still kicking it. Now we have two mutants left, and they're both connected. So this is going to be a little complicated. When Generation X starts, we meet a girl named M. Okay, her name is Monet. So she is basically perfect, is her what they say her power is. So she can, like, fly. She's super strong. She can lift, like, 75 tons or something. She kind of does all this cool stuff. She has, like, some telekinesis power. She's just generally awesome. We also meet a strange girl that Generation X finds called Penance. And Penance has red skin, and it's razor sharp. Like, even though she has, like, these big claws, like, all of her skin is just razor sharp, so no one wants to touch her. She doesn't speak, and she doesn't seem to understand English, so she's dangerous. No one really knows what's happening. So we have those two characters. So it turns out that Penance is really Monet. Okay? Monet is trapped in this body, unable to understand English. She can't speak. She's trapped in there. So who is Monet? Monet is her two younger sisters, okay, that combine together to look like Monet. Like, somehow their power is to, like, wonder twins and, like, become a person. So when M becomes Penance, they say, like, oh, well, we need an M now. We need to be Monet. So they form and become Monet. So after this whole thing, they manage to free the real Monet from Penance's body. So she's like, I'm free. And she is now M as we know her. The twins, eventually, they go into Penance's body. They kind of swap. Eventually, they leave that, and they're just off doing something. I don't know what they're doing. And now Penance doesn't seem to have anyone inhabiting that body. So they call her Hollow. I don't know if that's, like, her real superhero name, or if it's, like, slang, or, like, a slur, whatever. They call her Hollow. But she is still around. So we've seen images of the Avengers Academy, and she's there with all these other young students kind of learning or whatever. So she's there. And you might think, like, is there someone controlling her? And one of the writers came out and said, yes, someone is inhabiting that body, but we don't know who. That was a while ago, and I don't think they're ever going to solve that. I think they were just like, ooh, mystery, and I don't know if they're ever going to answer who is in Penance's body, because not many people, unless you're like me and read the comic book 19 years ago, really probably care. So the real M is still around. She's with the X-Men every once in a while. She's doing stuff. She's still kicking it. She fought alongside Jubilee and Husk for a while. She's still doing her thing, super strong, kicking ass and taking names. So that is the team Generation X. Again, this means really nothing to most of you. But for some of us that maybe read about this story or were big fans of Generation X back in the day, this is walking down memory lane. So they were one of my favorite teams, and some of these really cool heroes are still doing things, and some of them are straight up dead, but it's cool to see where they are now. So especially like Chamber, M, Penance, if they go back to that, you know, what's Husk up to? Is she gonna ever get fixed and kind of rejoin the team? So it's cool to see what might happen. This has nothing to do with movies, though there was a Generation X movie we won't talk about because it was horrible. But hopefully this was interesting, just to see what sort of teams were existing. At this time, there was like Generation X, X-Factor, Excalibur, X-Force. There were all sorts of X teams, and this was just the one that I really latched onto. So thanks for watching. Hopefully this was interesting, and we'll catch you later.